closer. The day is dark, but it's going to approach the bright and shining sun one day when he comes back and makes all things new. I'm asking that we, at this moment, stand with our hearts. If you want to stand, you can stand as well. I'm asking that we will reverently read the scriptures that's going to be on the screen right now. And I'm going to slide this out and put this on display. And we can read Matthew chapter 12, verse 1 through 8. Matthew chapter 12, verse 1 through 8. We read Daniel chapter 7 a little bit earlier, but now we're going to look at Matthew chapter 12, verse 1 through 8. It says, at that time, Jesus went through the grain fields on the Sabbath, and the disciples were hungry and began to pluck heads of grain to eat. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said to him, look, your disciples are doing what is not lawful to do on the Sabbath. But he said to them, have you not read what David did when he was hungry, and he and those who were with him? How he entered the house of God and ate the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, nor for those who were with him, but only for the priests? Or have you not read in the law that on the Sabbath the priests in the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless? Yet I say to you that in this place there is one greater than the temple. But if you had known what it means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless. The Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. I'm going to read verse 6 to 8 again. Yet I say to you that in this place, there is one greater than the temple. But if you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless. For the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. For the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. For these next few moments, we're going to look at the sermon title. The sermon title presented today is The Lord of Today. The Lord of Today. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Great God in heaven, we thank you so very much for you being God and God all by yourself. God, there is nothing that operates. You know each breath that we have breathed and the breaths that we will be breathing. Lord, you know the number of hairs on our head. You know every single aspect from the largest facade building to the smallest creature here on planet Earth, and not just here on planet Earth, throughout the whole universe. And so, God, we come to you at this moment and thanking you for your grandeur and your greatness. There is nothing of ourselves that we should ever exalt ourselves. We are simply dependent on you in every single aspect of our lives. So Lord, as you have brought us here, those who have joined today, Lord, this 23rd day of October, Lord, we thank you for what you've done. Allow me to have another year of life. But Lord, this is more about your day. And so Lord, we ask that you will speak to us. So Lord, disappoint us not. And Lord, let the words of my mouth, meditation of my heart, be the words of our mouths and meditation of our hearts. To be holy and acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength, and O Lord, truly our Redeemer. Let us all say together, amen. Amen and amen. The Lord of today. It is interesting about having certain events that happen on certain times. One thing, for example, as you see on the screen, the happy birthday that I put on this PowerPoint, and for those who are watching, those who may not be watching but are listening, you can understand there's a happy birthday banner right over some cake. I can't wait till what we're gonna have later on. My wife got a cake for me and I asked her to go to this place and she went to the place. But one thing is that she told me that I cannot look at it. It's in the refrigerator, it's in a box, but I have made a promise that I will not see what the cake it looks like until the time. It is something amazing to celebrate another year of life. I've come to this recognition is that really, as I've gotten older, Lizzie's birthday was 3 weeks ago. And as her birthday was 3 weeks ago, I was more excited about her birthday than I was necessarily about mine. Now, not saying I don't appreciate another year of life, but it's another day just to thank God for what he's done. Another breath to praise God that he's allowed me to have. But I'm so excited about Lizzie, because she was so excited about her birthday. She's just so proud to be 4. And all I just want to say is that that is so great about birthdays. You celebrate of something of a great situation. It's great. As we look at right now, family, We are in a time that has been perplexing. Things that used to be strong. I was watching an episode one day of how this one, for those who are familiar with New York City or the Northeastern area, there's a store that was big out there. We have down here Dick's. If you want to go to Dick's or you want to go to a sporting goods store, you can go there. But up in the Northeast area, it used to be a place called Modell's. And if you are familiar with that area or that area, you could type in, I remember Modell's. And it was an episode where it was Undercover Boss and the owner of Modell's came and he dressed down to meet up with people. As he met up with people, he did great things for them. But Modell's is no longer in business as of now. There is economy situations that occurred that kept them from continuing in their business, even though they had been in business for a long time. We have seen various things have changed. Restaurants, and there's a restaurant in Greenville, I forgot the name of it, that just announced that they had to close their doors down from downtown. There are events that have occurred, but there are places that people have made a seismic change of what they've done. One thing that has happened is that people used to go to movie theaters. Now, I'm not promoting or talking about movies at this particular moment per se. I don't want anybody coming up and say, Pastor, you know, we're not supposed to be watching movies. I'm not talking about that in this aspect, but we do recognize that we are in the world, but not of the world. Now, we do understand, like, you know, on Saturday nights and you driven by, let's say you want to get something to eat on Saturday night after the sun has set, amen. And you drive past a restaurant might be around a movie theater, and you will see cars lined up into the parking lot so people can go in and watch the film. But just like situations occur, businesses that have come and businesses unfortunately have been going away because of COVID, the aspect of going to a movie theater is not as prominent as it used to be. In fact, actually what they have done now is they have now started to create movies to be shown on television. In fact, there are people who have services where you can order something, it'll be shipped to you, you can get it in 2 or 3 days, and it's a prime time to get it. This company will even also show films and movies so you can watch. And what used to be a time that you would go to a theater and watch a movie coming out is no longer a time that you are at home to watch it once it's come through the theater and a few weeks has passed by and they've done some more editing and put other clips into it so you can have more of a backdrop of it. They've now had it that you can watch the film at home during the debut. And so films that were once supposed to be on the silver screen at a movie theater are now being shown in the houses at your own home, the TVs at your own homes. And one movie that came out that's really become a movie that has brought forth a lot of attention is this movie called The Tomorrow War. The Tomorrow War, and this year is 2021. We are living in 2021. And in this film, it's a film about a man who's aspiring to have an occupational increase, get a better job, get more money, just to better his life with his wife and his daughter. And as he was getting there and something happened and he started watching television, there was a lapse where the time came in and some people came from another place. And they said that we are people from 30 years ago, 2051. And we are now in a battle and we need your help right now. We need you to come 30 years into the future and help us fight this enemy that we can defeat it. It's called the Tomorrow War. It's speaking about what's going to happen in the tomorrow. Now, family, it's interesting because the Bible says by beholding, you become, and you can fill in the chat line, but by beholding, you become changed. It is very important that we are very mindful and prayerful about what we allow in our homes, what we allow on our TVs, what we put in our ears. Now, it doesn't necessarily just mean by beholding visually, but you can behold even audibly. You can listen to so many things that it starts to work on you and you start having a mindset that has gone counter to the word of God. It's the same thing about watching television, watching movies, reading books that are not edifying God. There are things that you can watch, and the Bible, if the Bible is true to its word, which I do believe and I hope and pray we are all under the sound of my voice. When the Bible says, by beholding, you become changed. There must be something that lets us know. Is there something that right now, October 23rd, 2021, this was based on 2021, that there would be some portal of some people coming 30 years in the future that says we need your help to help us fight this enemy 30 years in the future? Is there anything right now that allows us to have that technology that ports us 30 years in the future? But people will sit down and watch this film. People will sit down and observe this movie and put into their heads of something that could happen 30 years down the line. See, family, be careful of what you watch, because if you're not careful, what you watch will change you. Here we go now. Jesus, here we are in Matthew chapter 12. Jesus has his disciples. And as they're doing their journey, and Jesus is promoting in this portion of the scriptures in Matthew that is focusing on this special time that we are celebrating right now, he is focusing on this time in Matthew's focus. He is now sitting here and he is spending time with his disciples. And as his disciples got up and did something that was countercultural even in that time, and even as they made a journey, and as they were walking in the journey, they went past a field that had grain. And as they were passing this field that had grain, they got hungry and they started to eat of this and pulling from these grains and eating. And just like Jesus in his superstar status, he had some paparazzis who were always around him who were trying to find something to go against him. These paparazzis were not people who were trying to get his autograph or be excited that they were in his place. These paparazzis were people who were trying to use evidence against him to expose him, to try to make him look like who he wasn't, who he had said he was. He said he had declared that he's God. He's the Son of Man. He's the Son of God. And they tried to find something against him. And his companions, his friends, his 12 disciples, as they were learning, disciples, students, they were walking down and they saw something and they started eating from the grain fields. And the Pharisees said, got him, there he is. And they tried to come at him and try to make him feel like he was not being a person who was leading people right. Now, let me tell you how severe it got in those times. They even suggested that you don't even walk past corn or walk past grain. Because if you walk past it and your leg touched it, and if fail, it will even be considered in those times, in that culture, that you are actually doing harvesting. Like you were, as you walk past a grain and you touched it with your foot or your ankle and it fell off, you were doing work. And here we are, family. We have seen these paparazzi Pharisees coming at Jesus, trying to make him feel like he is not a good person, that he was doing things the wrong way. And they said to him, don't you see that what your disciples are doing, how they are breaking the Sabbath? And Jesus has a conversation with them. Talks to him about what David did when at the table showbread and how the priest allowed him to get of it. He even said later on, it's like he says right here in verse 5, or have you not read in the law that on the Sabbath, the priests in the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless? And we are seeing that there are people who are trying to attack Jesus, and particularly who's trying to attack the Sabbath. And I want to share with you right now, family, that we are living in a time where the people now are looking at something in a battle tomorrow. I want to share with you some important points. Important point number one is that Jesus gave us the Sabbath for freedom. Can somebody say amen? Jesus gave us the Sabbath for freedom. It was the time when the disciples, as they were doing ministry with God, and we're going to talk about that a little bit down the line, as they were doing ministry for God, Jesus has them walking, and they go past grain fields. They are hungry, and they go and get something. And the people in that time, the Pharisees, who were some years ago, because of their rebellion against God and the Babylonian and the Medo-Persian conquest of them, When they now got after the 70-year prophecy, they came back to Jerusalem. They now started to make the Sabbath in more restrictive ways, that there were so many laws that had to be kept. And if you went off of one of them, you couldn't walk so much distance. You couldn't do so many things. And if you went against that, you were going against the word of God, the word of God. But Jesus never gave that to us. He gave us the Sabbath, not for oppression, but actually for freedom. As the disciples were hungry, Jesus said, let's get some to eat. And they got some grains and they started to eat. The Sabbath was never to be oppressive. The Sabbath is always for freedom. That's why it says in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 and 30, he says, come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 12 says, moreover, I also gave them my Sabbaths to be a sign between them and me, that they may know that I am the Lord who sanctifies them. And let's see what it says in Genesis chapter 2, verse 1 to 3. It says, thus the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them were finished. And on the third day, and on the seventh day, God ended his work which he had done. He rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had done. Then the God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all his work which God had created and made. The Sabbath was made for freedom. Just go back with me and let's look back in Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, God creates every single thing. He puts in motion light where it was nothing. He puts in motion the division of the waters. He puts in motion of the establishment of the land. And he fills these places with sea creatures and land creatures. And on a sixth day, God then creates man, brings his hands down. God puts his hands into dirt, forms dirt, and breathes his breath into dirt. And dirt does no longer has the composition only of dirt, but now has the structure and physiology of mankind. And mankind, Adam, sees animals, and he sees that there's a male and a female. And he notices that there's no one comparable to him as they are with the other animals. And God gives Adam rest and wakes him up, gives him a wife. Can someone say amen? Gives him a helpmeet. And after that comes the Sabbath. God gives Adam and Eve the Sabbath to let them know, and they were created last to let them know that there was nothing that they could do of their own. Everything that they had was provided for them so they could just rest in their first full day of life, the seventh day Sabbath. And God was speaking with mankind. God was talking with mankind. God was loving mankind. God was spending intimate quality time with mankind so mankind could appreciate it. Now, here we are. The Sabbath was made for freedom because men did not have to worry about doing any kind of work. Everything that we have, God provided for us. All we had to do is follow his lead. It's to give us rest for our souls, which is the previous chapter. The context of what we're looking at right here is that Jesus is talking to the disciples. He's pointing to them that what's going to happen down the line. And he says that I have come that when you come to me and lay your cares upon me, all you are heavy laden, I am here to bear your burdens. I am here to give you rest. I will be the one who will take your heavy load, take your heavy yoke, give you mine, and you will have rest for your souls. And because of that, they could eat from the grains because God was with them. God is with us now. The time that the devil tries to make us feel like we're not worthy, the time that the devil tries to make us feel like we deserve death, the time that the devil tries to make us feel like we should be kicked out of God's love, it's a reminder every single Sabbath. Exodus chapter 31, verse 13, and also in Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 12, Jesus says, I have given them the Sabbath as a sign that I am sanctifying them. I'm taking my spiritual bleach, my blood, and I'm washing away their sins. What could wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So when I come, and when I come into church, when I come into Zoom, when I come in fellowship with brothers and sisters, I prefer we come into church, But when we come and worship, it is something special about a God who allowed us to get into the cars when people could get sick and have a heart attack and anything can happen to us. And God brings us to our destinations. We are there because it's truly by the mercies of God. And we are coming and we are saying that it's not by my might, it's not by my power, but it's by the Spirit of God. And he's working on me. He's purging me. He's cleansing me. He's taking me from me and putting in me him. Can somebody say amen if you want to say that the Sabbath is for freedom? God has given us this Sabbath day for freedom. Now, as he's given us a Sabbath day for freedom, I want to share with you the situation. It's now that we have seen that Jesus has been approached to because he has been in a position that he didn't beat down the disciples. And now Jesus is now approached with these paparazzi Pharisees. He's being spoken to about what is it that you know that they're doing, that what they're doing is not according to the law. And I want to share with you, family, point number two. Point number two is that tradition tries to kill the Sabbath. Let me say it again. Tradition tries to kill the Sabbath. These Pharisees see Jesus and starts to bring upon Jesus things that were never found in the first 39 books of the Bible, never found in the scriptures. They put their own traditions that they have tried to establish. And as they established their traditions, they were trying to use this to kill the Sabbath. That's what it says in Mark chapter 7, verse 8. This is what Jesus says to these people. He says at another time, he says, "For laying aside the commandment of God, you hold the tradition of men, the washing of pitchers and cups and many of such other things that you do." These people who were talking about how the disciples and Jesus were about to eat food without washing their hands. And they established their traditions over the word of God, his commandments. They tried to establish their stance, their beliefs, their knowledge over what God has explicitly told us. And they tried to use their tradition to kill the Sabbath. Why, instead of it being a time of freedom, people would feel like they made a step too much, that they were breaking the Sabbath. When they were doing something that was not going contrary to the word of God, the enemy tried to make what they used to be lax in Sabbath keeping and lax in following the word of God and lax in following God's requests, have now changed it to do a 180. Instead of they being lax, they were strict. And tradition tries to kill the Sabbath. Let's look. Listen to what it says right here. Thank you, Lynn, for reading the scripture. Now, I'm not going to read all of Daniel chapter 7, verse 19 to 25, but I want us to turn and you can write down Daniel chapter 19, verse 7, verse 19 through 25. And I'm going to read right here, and I'm going to read more so verses 23 to 25. And it says, "The fourth beast shall be the fourth kingdom on earth, which shall be different from all other kingdoms. He shall devour the whole earth, trample it and break it in pieces. The 10 horns are the 10 kings who shall arise from this kingdom. And another shall rise after them. He shall be different from the first ones. It shall subdue 3 kings. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and intend to change times and law. Then the saints shall be given into his hand for a time and times and half a time." Don't you notice what I just read to you in verse 25 in particular? That this beast, this fourth beast, as we understand, and I want us to just go with the backdrop of the book of Daniel. The head of gold represents Babylon. The chest represents Medo-Persia. I'm saying the chest represents Medo-Persia. The waist represents Greece. The legs represent Rome. And that's the fourth of the metals, and it's the same thing as the beast. This fourth beast is different than any of the other beasts. It looked different than any other beast because this beast had a power of both of nation, of civil, and also of religious. It's a different beast. And out of this beast, we start to see that there's 10 horns, and these 10 kingdoms come out of it. And 3 of them get pulled up by a new horn. And this horn power speaks pompous things against the Most High. He's to try to then persecute the saints. He's to try to think that he can have this power, that he can change times and law. Change times and law. It has become a tradition where this power thinks that it can change times and law. Back to the Tomorrow War. I have shared with you, and I'm going to share with you some more, that I praise God. And I don't praise God about the unfortunate situations that have occurred with this cumulative thing that COVID has brought forth. But I praise God that God allowed the COVID situation to happen, not for us to be afraid. If we are living our lives afraid of something we can't see, if we are living our lives afraid of thinking that a mask is only the method that will protect us, and if we think that only that we can do is get a vaccination that will protect us, if we think that that's the only thing that can keep us alive, we have disrespected the power of God. God has kept us all this time. He's kept us in flus. He kept us in other situations. He's kept us, there may have been people who are in a grocery store and someone wanted to pull out a gun, but God sent his angel and kept it at bay and we didn't even know of it. If we think that it's something man does that protects us, we have disrespected the power of God. But I praise God that God has allowed COVID to happen for this one reason, because it wakes us, it should wake us up to let us know that Jesus is coming back soon. It should let us be aware that our lamps need to be trimmed and burning, preparing for Jesus Christ to come back. So one thing that I have been more mindful about, and I praise God that God has allowed it, that he's allowed that this stuff would let me not get caught up watching all this television. Because I don't need to watch the news telling me of all these things. It's out there, but God is stronger. God is greater. God is bigger. Can somebody say amen? But I was informed about this film, The Tomorrow War. And it speaks, like I said earlier at the beginning of the message, that the year is based off of 2021. And 30 years in the future, there are going to be people who are going to come transport into 2021 and ask for help to fight an enemy that has come. It's these alien invaders. These alien invaders are called white spikes. And these alien invaders, as they have come, they have brought carnage to the whole world. They've gone to various cities and what used to be people having great times and enjoying and shopping and feasting and all this stuff. These white spikes come and they are coming and they have brought havoc. In fact, actually the film, and I saw a little bit of the film, and the people who fought the battle and able to survive, they even say it was a 30% survival rate of those from 2021, and they fight and they come back. And when they come back, they are horrified of what they saw of these white spikes. But one thing that they found out about these white spikes that they said that it's interesting and they're using it to come to retaliate on them, is that these white spikes fight for 6 days, but they rest on the seventh day, which they call the Sabbath. They are a group, an alien invasion, who have come on planet Earth, and they brought carnage to planet Earth, which was seemingly in its bliss. And they fought, and they've killed 70% of people who come from 2021, and they're about to wipe out the whole Earth. They fight for 6 days, and on the seventh, the Sabbath, they rest. And now the battle is for them to destroy these white spikes who work for 6 days and rest on the seventh day. Now, family, spiritually things are spiritually discerned. Come with me right now. I'm not advocating you to watch the film. In fact, actually, truth be told, I was going to say I didn't even watch the end of the film. I wanted to see that little portion. But as I saw that portion, it let me realize that as we're watching these films, especially these films that are talking about invaders from out of space and invaders from other places, it is speaking of a time when God is going to come back and get his people from labor to reward. And the people who are fighting this quote-unquote alien invasion are not people who are fighting on the good side. It is flipped. It's actually people in the subliminal. It's people who are actually fighting on the wrong side. And God is posed as the alien. And it's mankind's job to thwart back the alien invasion so that mankind can have planet Earth all by themselves. It is now talking about the tomorrow war, where we're seeing an attempt to battle and fight tomorrow. Now, we just spoke about it. This is a subliminal message of people who are going to stand for God and keep the seventh-day Sabbath. By beholding, you become changed. It's those people who are aliens. It's those people who brought carnage to us. It's those people who have brought a pain to this world. We're going to have to fight them. But let me tell you something. We need to be prayerful about ourselves as Seventh-day Adventist Christians. For those who are not Seventh-day Adventist Christians who are on this chat line, who are on this Zoom line, welcome to worship. But God allowed you to be here to listen to this message or watch this. But we are living in a time where we have to keep aware of this one thing, is that as we have the Bible and as we have the pen of inspiration, as we have had the Book of Great Controversy, as we are in prayer meeting going over Last Day Adventist, don't you think that Satan is dumb that he's not going to see what has been written 100 plus years in advance and think that what we have tried to prescribe as a way of how the last days will come is exactly how the last days will come? See, the Bible tells us that Satan will try to deceive even the very elect. And if we think that we know every single thing of how what's going to happen in the very last days, we are deceiving ourselves. Because the devil is like a roaring lion, and lions don't come out and make a whole bunch of roaring noise. They come in subtly to roar, to scatter, and then find somebody they can attack. And so what we're looking at right now is that there is something that's being set up to get us prepared for this war down the line. Earlier this month, Pope Francis and a whole bunch of other religious leaders in other nations, religious leaders in particular, came together and they start speaking about something that is something that we should be concerned about. We should be concerned about the world that we live in. We should be concerned about the state of our world. But I want us to understand this, is that what they have come together, and from what they were talking about, it is an event where they brought the Archbishop of Canterbury. They brought some Orthodox Ecumenical Parish, Bartholomew. They brought representatives of Islam, representatives of Judaism, Hinduism, Sikhism, Buddhism, Confucianism, Taoism, Zoroastrianism, Jainism. It was a group of people, leaders, who represent 84% of the world's total population. We have approximately 7.8 billion people on planet Earth right now. 84% of the 77.8 billion people, those leaders of these religious groups, came and met up with Pope Francis of trying to put together this event called Faith and Science towards COP26. What it is talking about of this towards COP26 is that we live in a world that has a drastic, large problem of global warming. It is something that it has been attributed to vehicles and attributed to planes and attributed to mankind with its desire to build and to have grand companies and grand industries. And what it has done in the toll of its entrepreneurialism has caused a wear and tear on our environment. And what needs to be done is that there is trying to work together of something like a Green Sabbath or a Climate Sunday, a day where people stop working and they start resting their businesses so that the world will no longer start to go to deteriorating effect from global warming. Now that sounds very noble, but I want us to understand a couple of things, because point number one is this, is that there are other issues that are causing global warming. As we can look at the screen, it's talking about on the screen, is that on the screen, I'm gonna show you a slide, it's talking about really that in 2019, the United States methane emissions by source. We have seen that the largest one and methane, they're talking about carbon dioxide, but really speaking, the dangerous thing is really methane. Methane holds 30% more. It traps heat in longer. It is more dangerous to our environment than carbon dioxide. And in this methane, there has been natural gas, petroleum system, 30%, others 9%, coal mining, 7%, landfill, 17%, manure management, 9%, and enteric fermentation, 27%. It is speaking about this is really what we should be mindful about rather than talking about cutting down businesses on a particular day. But what we have seen is that in this enteric is speaking about livestock-based methane emissions. And when you see a cow, a cow has four parts in its stomach. And the first part of it, it's the rumen. In the Bible, they're called ruminants. And what they do in that first part of the stomach, it chews and it regurgitates, and it's called cow belches. And 95% of a cow's emission, methane emission from a cow, is belches. 5% is from the rectum. But as you look on the other side, a cow produces 295 grams of methane on a day. A buffalo, 404 grams. A milk cow, 87 grams. Pigs, 55 grams. Chicken, 35 grams. In a day, a cow produces this much, and there are approximately 1.5 billion cows. The cows are producing all this methane in their belches. And it's now coming down to this, that it is the greenhouse gas that's more potent than carbon dioxide. The cows produce a lot of methane in their digestion. Number three says greenhouse gases trap heat from sun rays, causing the earth to warm up. And number four is what blows my mind, is that it says a new study found that selectively breeding cows or manipulating their gut microbes could help them save the environment. We're not talking about animals with their gas releases. We're not talking about animals with all this industrialism that mankind is doing, that we need to eat more beef, we need to eat more steak, we need to eat more burgers. It's been said that if there's a way to limit the global warming, it's to stop eating a whole bunch of meat. Come on now, they don't talk about that. It's not about the carbon dioxide, it's not about the planes, is about the gas that comes out the animals. And animals that are just grown simply for the cause of human consumption. If we will cut that out and start eating more plant-based, we wouldn't have to worry about setting aside a day of no longer working. It has now become to the position of, as we have been seeing, as I spoke about, unfortunately, but I spoke about with the vaccination, that they're starting to put together mandates and coercing people. We're now starting to see a religious system that's trying to set forth all other religious groups, represent 84% of the population, to mandate a day where now you don't have work any longer. Now, if we think that Satan's gonna come at us one way, he's like a roaring lion. He comes a subtle way, another way. The COP26 is a subtle way for mankind, humanity, to stop working on, as it was said, quote, climate Sunday. To rest on Sunday, to ignore the seventh-day Sabbath. And when we should have rested on the Sabbath, we're now resting on a spurious Sabbath. The Sabbath, as I'm celebrating my birthday, the Sabbath truly is the best birthday of all. It is the day where we recognize God creating the heavens and earth. I celebrate my birthday once every 365 days. But every Sabbath, we come and we acknowledge that the God who created 6 days and established the seventh day to rest, it is the best birthday we could ever have. Have you ever seen a birthday without a birth certificate? I mean, a passport without a birth certificate? The only way we can get a passport to take us to that place where no man, where we've never seen, a place where that there's going to be a sea of glass and a tree of life, a beautiful place. The only way we can get to that place is if we recognize the birth certificate, which is the Sabbath. And we have seen that every single seventh day, the Sabbath that God has given us. Now, listen, I'm showing to some stuff. We're going to look at the history of Sunday worship because it's looking to be brought forth again, as we spoke about in Daniel chapter 7, that man's going to think that they could change times and law. AD 31, 32, 135, Jews were persecuted by Rome as a result of the revolt led by Bar Kokhba. Christians were trying to distance themselves from Jews. However, the mutual observance of the seven-day Sabbath was starting to be separated on worshiping on different days. People, before they became Christians, worshiped the sun on Sunday in their pagan ritual. It's a pagan day. Some more. For consideration of making Christianity more attractive to non-believers, many Christians started to worship on both Sabbath and Sunday. Constantine in AD 321 established that shops, governmental functions be closed on the venerable day of the sun, the first day of the week. What we have seen, what we are speaking about in 321, now we are seeing that they are trying to establish it some 1700 years later. That there is going to be an attempt to one day for us to stop working on the first day. And because of that, Sunday became the official day of worship at the Council of Laodicea in AD 364. Think to change times and laws. Now, in the film about the white spice, and they had their Sabbath, for those who don't know much about the Sabbath may not even recognize that. They may look down and say, okay, that's a weird day. Well, you know, I know Saturday, blah, blah, blah. But there's a man named Dr. William Meade Jones. And what he did was he did some research. He was a Seventh-day Baptist. And what he did is he looked at and tried to find about true Sabbath. And he did research on 160 languages. And out of that, this is what he found out. He said, and I'm going to quote, it says, in every one of these languages, the days of the week appear in the same order. And in 108 of them, the Saturday was called the seventh day, the Sabbath, or the rest day. And these are some of the days that you see, and I'm not going to read all of it for time's sake, but you're seeing that there are in these languages, Russian, Sabota, Serbian, Sabota, Spanish, Sabado, there are references to Sabbath. We've even seen over there in the Afghan, Shamba. Ancient Syriac, Shabbat. We see Ethiopian or Ethiopic, Sanbat. French, Samedi, which is Sabbath day. Greek, Sabbaton. Hebrew, Shabbat. We have seen that the Sabbath is still established, even recognized by the languages. There is an attempt to attack mankind, those who follow God, and ultimately an attempt to attack God by trying to make his day seem of an alienistic invasion to mankind. And there's going to be an attempt to try to create a spurious and establish this false day of worship. Like it says in Malachi, I'm the Lord, I change not. The seventh day is the creator of heaven and earth. He made the seventh day Sabbath. But mankind is trying to establish Sunday, the venerable day of the sun. And like the little boy said, if God made the Sabbath monument, who made this one? We are looking at a time on this film, The Tomorrow War, where millions of people watched it, may have been entertained, eating their popcorn and enjoying it. But as Christians, seventh-day keeping, Sabbath-keeping Christians, followers of God, and for those who have come and not known about the Sabbath and are just coming for the first time again, welcome. But we are in a time where we are starting to see as easy as it was to get people to fall in line, on the aspect of getting vaccinated, where they never recognize the situation of our body, if we have natural immunity, if we have had developed our antibodies for those who have been sick, it's now become this or that. And this venerable day of the sun is being slowly trying to be lifted above the day God created as the true birthday, the seven-day Sabbath. This is what Sister White says. She says, as Sabbath has become the special point of controversy, I'm gonna slide this up, throughout Christendom, the religious and secular authorities have combined to enforce the observance of the Sunday. The persistent refusal of a small minority to yield to the popular demand will make them objects of universal execration to get rid of. It will be urged that the few who stand in opposition to an institution of the church and a law of the state ought not to be tolerated. That it's better for them to suffer than for the whole nations to be thrown into confusion and lawlessness. I'm going back to where it is. If you don't take this shot, You are causing harm to people. If you don't rest on this day, you are causing harm for this world. I'm telling you, family, we need to keep our eyes aware. Satan is trying to have these things, and he uses one thing to bring something else up. It's better for them to be, for them to suffer, that they can't buy it, that they can't sell, than for whole nations to be thrown into confusion and lawlessness. The same argument many centuries ago was brought against Christ by the quote-unquote rulers of the people. It is expedient for us, said the wily Caiaphas, that one man should die for the people and that the whole nation perish not, John 11:50. This argument will appear conclusive, and a decree will finally be issued against those who hallow the Sabbath of the fourth commandment, denouncing them as deserving of the severest punishment and giving the people liberty after a certain time to put them to death. Eradicate those people. Eradicate those white spikes who keep the seventh, the Sabbath, who work 6 days. Eradicate them. Eradicate those who keep the seventh-day Sabbath. Romanism in the old world and apostate Protestantism in the new will pursue a similar course toward those who honor all the divine precepts. Traditions of man will try to kill the Sabbath. We are seeing this right now. Page 615, Great Controversy. We are seeing this right now, family. And Lord, open our eyes that we may see. This is not a time for us just to have, and I'm not saying we don't enjoy the days. Man, I'm going to enjoy time with my family. But we can't be thinking that we have so much more time down the line. Because what we are seeing right now in our very eyes is setting up for something. And we're not keeping our eyes open to what's going on around us, we will be caught off guard. Like I said earlier, sin's like a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And he is an ant will make a roar and try to scatter us. Point number one, Jesus gave us the Sabbath for freedom. Point number two, tradition tries to kill the Sabbath. When people think that they can change the Sabbath and they think that, that Paul was trying to change laws, this is what he says in Romans chapter, Romans chapter 3, verse 31. He says, do we then make void the law through faith? Certainly not. On the contrary, we establish the law. Mankind has never, God has never given permission to change anything God has established. Because the Sabbath is part of the Ten Commandments. And the Ten Commandments are a transcript of God's character. And God has said, I am the Lord, I change not. He can't change his character. So if he can't change his character, he ain't going to change the Sabbath. And if he try, if anybody tries to change the Sabbath, they're trying to change themselves as being God. Pharisees, thinking that they were fighting for the good cause, were actually fighting for a wrong cause. They tried to bring their traditions to kill the Sabbath, which was given to us as for freedom from all this muck that we're going through. But listen to what it says, point three. Jesus' lordship offers blessings to others. Jesus' lordship offers blessings to others. This is what he says in verses 6-8. He says right here, yet I say to you that in this place there is one greater than the temple. But if you had known what this means, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, you would not have condemned the guiltless. And this is what he says in verse 8. He says, for the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath. As they tried to establish their traditions over God, as they tried to say that they have the ability to put the disciples underneath discipline, and Jesus should recognize that, and he should be under discipline too because he was compliant with that, Jesus established that he is greater than the temple. And not only is he greater than the temple, he is Lord of the Sabbath. And as he's Lord of the Sabbath, he doesn't put any condemnation on his disciples. This is what he does. Let's look what it says in verse 9 to 13. Verse 9 to 13 later on tells us that there's a man with a withered hand, and this man with a withered hand on the same day that Jesus with the disciples at the grain fields sees this withered man and says, stretch out your hand. This man stretches out his hand and he brings healing on the Sabbath. Can someone say amen? God gives us a Sabbath for letting us know that he's sanctifying us. God has given us a Sabbath to let us know that he's freeing us from all this, these problems. And God has given us a Sabbath to let us know that it is good to do well. It is lawful to do good on the Sabbath. His lordship offers blessings, not just to us, but to everybody who recognizes him and comes to him on the Sabbath day. That's why it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17, it says, now the Lord is a spirit. It's a spirit. And where the spirit of the Lord is, there's liberty. When we are in Jesus Christ, we have liberty. We have freedom. We have peace. We have blessed assurance that Jesus is ours. And so people will say, like, what about in Revelation chapter 1, verse 10? It says, and I was in the spirit on the Lord's day, and I heard behind me a loud voice as of a trumpet. It doesn't say that I was in the spirit on the Lord's day. Yes, that's the case. But the Bible tells us and that the spirit, that the Lord's day is the Sabbath. When we are in Jesus, he gives us liberty. And when we are in the spirit, he gives us that liberty. Where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And when we come together on the Lord's day, we have liberty on that day. So whatever mankind tries to contrive, whatever mankind tries to put up together, is nothing that they can do that will take away the lordship of the seven-day Sabbath that Jesus established, where he rested, he blessed it, and he hallowed it. He made it, he sanctified it, he made it holy. The disciples ate from the grain field. Can somebody say amen? We can also come to Jesus in our situation. We eat of Jesus Christ. We feast on him in his word. We have peace in this storm that comes upon us. And when we have that, the illnesses of our lives, the witheredness of our lives, when we present them to Jesus, he takes them away. He makes us new. He makes us whole. Because when we have the Spirit of God in us, we can rest truly on the seventh day. I recommend for those who haven't done it, I'm recommending that every seventh day, I mean, the Sabbath, when sun sets on the sixth day on Friday, it comes to open up the seventh day, the Sabbath. I strongly recommend it, family, that you come together and you have family worship. Don't just come to church and that's your first time of having worship on a Sabbath. I strongly encourage that you have if you have children. If you don't have children, you're married, you don't have children in the house, or you don't have children at all. Or if you are married, or if you're not married and you're single, please open up the Sabbath when the sun sets. In Australia, in their state flag, in their nation flag, there is a picture of an emu, and there's a picture of a kangaroo. And people who are looking at that aspect of the emu and the kangaroo were wondering, what is the significance of them? See, in the significance of the emu and the significance of the kangaroo, it's one thing that a zoologist noticed, and a person noticed, is that the zoologist, the animal expert, recognized that emus, and kangaroos can never go backward. They can never go backward. An emu and a kangaroo can only go forward. And because they go forward, it was the national symbol of Australia to keep on going forward, never go backward. See, when we come together, family, on the Sabbath, when we come together and we welcome and we open the Sabbath and we pray and we spend time with each other. We read the word of God. We read our devotion together. And we welcome the Sabbath. It lets us know that the devil may try to throw a blow at us to take us back. But when we are anchored in Jesus Christ, we can only move forward. When the devil tries to take us, knock us down, the Bible says that a just man may fall seven times, but gets on back up. We can only move forward. When the enemy may try to bring storms for a night, but we can have joy in the morning, we can move forward. It is this blessed day that we set aside, that we come and fellowship on the true birthday, Earth's birthday, and thank God for what he has done. He has given us a Sabbath for freedom. It has been set up that it has been now the time that tradition will try to kill the Sabbath, but it will not kill the Sabbath. And one person said this, and it blew my mind. Point number three is that Jesus' lordship offers blessings to others. This man's name is Dr. Tim Jennings, and he made a very powerful statement. And I may not say it correctly, I'm paraphrasing. But he said this, he said, truth will one day come out. It's going to eventually come out. You cannot hide truth. Now, the problem is that when will you find out about the truth? Because eventually, if people try to bury the truth for so long, it's going to come and reveal itself when Jesus comes back. But truth can never be covered and hidden, because Jesus is the way, the life, and in the middle of it, the truth. The way, the truth, and the life. Jesus will never be hidden. Jesus will never be buried. His lordship offers blessings to others. So, yes, today I am excited. I'm 42 years of age. Thank you, Jesus, for life, health, and strength. But isn't it amazing that every single week we all can celebrate the birthday of planet Earth and celebrate every Sabbath of what Jesus has given to us? It is a day for us to be in true rest. I'm going to give you a homework assignment, and I'm going to encourage that you never do this again. If you do this, never do this again. Don't go into your mailbox looking at your mail on the Sabbath. Amen. Let the mail be in the mail. Let the bill stay in the mailbox. You don't need all that stress on the seventh day. Because what it is Jesus already let us know that he's given us life, health, and strength. And as Elder Brother gave us to us, is that he's blessed us with wealth. He's blessed us with the ability to have money in our pocket. If we trust in him, he will do whatever needs to be done. This is why he says there's 1,000 ways that we don't even know of, that he will intervene and do something on our behalf. But we're worrying about it on today. We're not truly trusting his strength and power. We rest on it. Don't look in the mailbox. Rest on the day. You can go into it on tomorrow or tonight. But rest today. Can somebody say amen? I want to say happy birthday to planet Earth. Because every seventh day, we acknowledge the lordship of what God has done. I thank you, Lord, for giving me strength. I thank you, Lord, for giving us physical abilities. I thank you, Lord, for giving us families. Thank you for giving us places over our heads, cars to drive, gas in the tank, food in our stomach, roof overhead, to be blessed. And thank you, Lord, for the Sabbath day so I can rest knowing that what you have started is what you can finish. If you believe that God, you want to thank God for what he's done on this seventh day, the Sabbath, Earth's birthday. Say thank you, Jesus, for this birthday. Let us bow our heads for prayer. Lord God, we are living in some interesting times. Lord, TV, movies, we try to bring forth agendas, and they plot it with lights and bells and whistles, people, actors, actresses, what they have done with computer effects that gravitate our eyes and mesmerize us. But Lord, underneath it, there's some subliminal message that's being brought forth. And Lord, if we don't recognize it, first of all, it's best that we stay away from it. But Lord, in that all, Lord, we pray that we will not be caught up in what mankind tries to promote around us. Lord, we have seen this, we have heard in this message today about this film, this Tomorrow War, of ultimately a battle against alien invasion, those who keep the seven-day Sabbath, keep the Sabbath. Lord, we're seeing that there's going to be one day where there's going to be Armageddon and people are going to think that there's more of us than of them and we can eradicate them. But Lord, it's mankind thinking that they can kill in their traditions the Sabbath. But you've given us a Sabbath for freedom. You've given us a Sabbath for liberty. And Lord, you are truly Lord of the Sabbath. You want to extend it to others. Lord, we pray as we are here right now, we are celebrating this day, this birthday, every 7 days. We pray, God, that we will extend this to other people. The person who has an emotionally withered hand, a person who has a financially withered hand. Lord, let us give them encouragement of the God who can take their withered hand of their lives and make it whole through him, through Jesus. And Lord God, we ask for anybody who's under the sound of my voice, who may be nervous, but Lord, in you, we have the victory. Yes, Armageddon is going to one day occur, but you're going to make this earth new, and no longer will we have the blight of sin, no light, we have the blight of evil. We have the peace in you forever. So Lord, if there's somebody who wants to make a dedication to life, Lord, let them put on the chat line to myself or the Maranatha Fellowship host, and put it in there, and we'll communicate after that. But God, we ask at this time that we will keep you, and we thank you for blessing us on this special day. Happy birthday, Jesus, for giving us planet Earth. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us planet Earth, and happy birthday. This we ask in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This we pray. Amen.